But I must tell you that I was the patron of two schools for almost 4 years, which had 4,000 students each. So I'm very, I'm familiar with the functioning and how schools operate. And I think what you said is a grave concern. It is not post-COVID. Let me put it in the right perspective. COVID is not going to end.
I want this to come from you, sir. That is why I did not mention. I want this point. Yeah.
So we have a lockdown which has been enforced by the government. That lockdown is being slowly eased, as we are aware, because you know the economic activity has to start taking place. But that does not mean that the threat of contracting COVID has gone down. So even when lockdown opens, I don't see parents being comfortable sending their children to school till such time as a vaccine is discovered and students are vaccinated and then they are protected from COVID. So that, as far as what is being spoken about, is going to take 12 to 18 months. And from when lockdown opens to 12 to 18 months or 12 months, whatever it is, this period, how will schools function? I think is a cause of concern for everybody. And that is what I think we need to talk about. There are so many aspects in this, and I will let you take it on from there.
Yes, sir. That I just wanted to you to speak that COVID is never going to end, but what we need to take precautions so we can move further. So my first question to you, I have posted this topic to many of the educationalist groups, and the questions which I have come across is, first question what comes into mind is, when can school reopen? When do you expect the schools to reopen?
You know, in my opinion, schools can only reopen if the entire format of schools change. They cannot reopen in the form that they have been functioning till date. You can't have social distancing when we're talking of a student-teacher ratio of up to 40 in a class. Obviously, now, therefore, your student-teacher ratios have to reduce drastically. And that drastic reduction means more teachers, more space, or phasing of the classes, whether you have some people in the morning or some in the evening, or you follow a 70-30 approach where you do distant learning for 70% of the time and only for 30% of the syllabus they come to school. Now, these are formats which all of you who are here, the educationists, have to talk about. But these are the kind of options that will have to be seen if you feel that your schools can open immediately, even before a vaccine is introduced.
Okay, so this was from the point of educationist. Now, if we see from the parents' point of view, will the parents send their children to school until a vaccine is found?
If I have a child going to school, I will not send him to school because I am not sure and confident as to how he will travel from home to school. Because today the buses, you know, they are piled on top of each other, the children. So therefore you need social distancing in transportation. You need social distancing in school. Children don't listen to each other, to the teachers. There will be, you know, violation of the social distancing. So I will not be comfortable sending my child. And that is the biggest question.
Correct. So, till the time the vaccine is not found and the parent are not comfortable sending their kids to school, how can the classes be conducted till the schools reopen?
Now, I think that everybody knows they're already conducting online classes. But, you know, I have few issues I have questions for this online classes. So, if you have classes real time, like we had in schools earlier, and you had a student-teacher ratio of, say, 40. Is that 40 still applicable when you do online classes? Is it efficient? Can one teacher with online classes address 40 students in the same one period, which was being done earlier? Or do you need a better student-teacher ratio? A lesser one. You need 20, you need 10, you need 15. That is something for you all to decide because you are the professionals and you are the people who are doing it. But this question comes to my mind as to what will be the ideal student-teacher ratio in online classes. Secondly, how do you do practicals? For students where, like in science subjects, some practicals are also to take place. Therefore, you will have to now work out whether that practical for that practical, those students can come to school or they can't, with social distancing, with all the precautions. Can you convince the parents to send them? I'm talking of parents who are informed and parents who are concerned. I'm sure there are a lot of parents who say, okay, inko lockdown khatam hua, inko bhagao, because they have been troubling us for 2 months. There are a lot of parents who are also fed up with the children at home. I understand that.
Most of them.
But the reality of it also is the danger that what will happen when students go to school.
Okay. Now, as you said, you have been into education since quite a long time. As per you, what should be the student ratio for different age group, if you can guide us as per you?
I don't think I am competent to give you that answer because I have not conducted online classes.
Okay.
So somebody who's doing these classes, the teachers on ground, if you take a feedback, I'm sure they'll be able to, you know, dispassionately tell you that we can manage so many students online. You know, students don't listen to teachers even in class. How they will listen to them online, what age category, because different age categories have a different response. So when you're looking at very young children, then you have the middle-aged children, and then you have the senior children. So there will have to be different ratios for different age groups based on how responsible they are. I think this is the teachers are best suited to answer.
Yes, true, sir. Now my next question comes, how will we ensure children who do not have internet or adequate band to attend the classes? Because see, when we talk about Zoom, we talk about online classes, you know, in India, majority of the places are villages wherein even if they have a bandwidth, the connection is not proper. Or many of the places, they don't have a good connection. So how can we deal with the kids of those areas? How can we reach out remote areas? Any suggestions you would?
So I was also thinking about this. If the bandwidth is not there, then obviously the classes can't be interactive online. But surely the classes can be in terms of providing them the material in a digital copy, whether it's a pen drive being given to them or it's a CD which is being given to them. And therefore, they will require some kind of a courier service between the school and the children where this thing is given and then the same thing being collected with the necessary homework or whatever tasks you may give them. Because if bandwidth is not there, you can't say that now we can't conduct on-ground classes and we can't conduct online classes, so there'll be no education. In my opinion, this could be a workable solution. Of course, only when time passes, when you carry it out, you will get to know whether it is efficacy, whether it works or doesn't work.
Yes, sir. I really appreciate your point that, as you said, it can be courier to the places. Like now, how most of the things, the basic essentials, it is being courier to all of us. Like online, maybe we can get our basic essentials. The same way, if the government takes a decision to provide the books through courier services, I think that will help along with the solutions, along with the CDs, whatever you are suggesting. I think that would really make a lot of difference for the students who are not able to use this online facility.
Actually, the point I had here was a little different. Hmm. You know, the basic syllabus, books, they can be a one time and it can all be, I'm sure it's available even now digitally. You can get soft copies.
Correct.
But I am talking of the interaction between the teacher and the student, where some kind of assignments are given and then they are delivered to the student, and after 2 days or 3 days or 1 day, whatever time you decide, they are then picked up by a courier and then got back to the teacher, who goes through them and gives a feedback to say, this was correct, this was wrong, you didn't do this. I'm talking about that part.
Okay.
And that would mean a very constant movement between the teacher and the students in whatever form, whether the schools organize it, the teachers organize it, the government organizes it. That is now only a modality, how it is done. But it would require constant movement of material between the student and the teacher.
Yes, I agree to it. So, as per you, even for online classes, there should be an emotional connect between the teacher and the student. Just providing online classes is not a solution. Do you agree with that, sir? As you said that...
You know, so far we have been only talking of academics.
Correct.
But school is not only about academics.
Correct.
School is a holistic development of a child, where the child learns many other skills apart from academics. Now, by virtue of not being able to make contact with other students, these skills will have to be also introduced in terms of a syllabus to teach them social etiquette, to teach them how to, you know, dress, how to behave. Earlier, as a group, they were taught by means of the discipline which was instituted in the schools, in the institutions. But now it won't be there if you're looking at this period being in a year, 2 years, I don't know how long. But this will also have to be looked at. And the other aspects of extracurricular activities. The holistic development of the child in terms of other than academics. Right now, academics is online. Everything else is offline.
Sir, I would like to add on, you don't know much about Fun to Learn, but Fun to Learn deals with beyond academics, the skills which you are talking about. We deal with that and we are trying to reach out remote areas. We have recently, we are training teachers for NGOs also who can reach out remote places and give life skills beyond academics, like their mathematical skill development, their writing skills, their social etiquettes. So Fun to Learn has already started working on that.
I think this is the right time for you to launch for all these other people also.
Yes, sir. We are open. We are open. First few days, I was also in a setback. What to do? And then I said, no, we have to be on our gears. We cannot sit back just waiting for the situations to be normal. And not only India, sir. This COVID-19 has made Fun to Learn reach out globally. We have started training students of United Kingdom as well. So for this, it is a boom for educationists. We just have to see what we can do, how we can do it. We have to be a little bit innovative and we can reach out beyond academics. We can reach out to maximum students. Now, my next question comes to you is, if you need a better student-teacher ratio and need to hire more teachers, how will be the finances taken care of by the school?
Because that's a question I was going to ask you. This is what all these principals out here have to think.
Yes,
are they going to charge more fees? Sir, although the government has already put a cap on increasing any fees apart from taking only tuition fee during this lockdown period. I saw that in Haryana. I don't know about other places. So where will this money come from? Will you cut down on the teacher salaries? Will you increase the fees to the students? Will you come down, reduce administrative staff? This is a question they have to answer.
That is what, and most of the participants here are principals and management. So that is a question to them.
Yeah.
From their end, they have this question mark, like if it's a budget school, then how do they cope up with this? Because if they are having 40, 50 students on one online session, it is not working for them. And as per the government, they are asking us not to cut down the, not to take fees from the students, then to pay the salaries to their employees as well as their domestic help. Now, how do then the budget school cope up? See, international schools, it's a different scenario. They can still go do all the things without cutting down anybody's salary. But budget school, do you have any option? Because currently most of the educationists are in a fix how to deal with this situation. Because you
I thought
know,
the order you... was, the order only spoke that mm-hmm. don't charge fees other than tuition fee. They've not said that don't charge tuition fee. But maybe the schools find it a pinch because they were recycling the other fees also into what you're talking about. Otherwise, if you're charging tuition fee and that is what it was being used for, then there's no change because there is no expenditure on electricity. There should be no expenditure on transportation and other stuff. You can't be charging students for transportation when they're not going to school. So what I read the government's order was that tuition fee can be charged and other fees should not be charged. Now, I don't know. That is something that I think principals can tell you best, not me.
Correct. But just let me tell you, transportation, now suppose the transportation fees is not charged. Okay. Now every school, they have a fixed set of buses. What about their salary? And the transportation fee does not just include the salary of the driver or the attendees. It includes their depreciation cost, the EMI cost, and many other costs. So just government saying that just check the tuition fee does not materialize. So we have to work on that.
I want to comment out here that,
yes,
you know,
sir.
47 million jobs have been lost already in the US.
Yes, I know, sir. 20%.
And you have introduced this topic 20%. By saying these are trying times. COVID has changed the face of the world.
Correct.
There are people who are taking cuts in their salaries. So even schools will have to take cuts in their profits. We can't say we are spending X and this X has to come. Otherwise, we can't function. You will have to make it X minus whatever. And so everybody will have to take a cut and everybody will have to suffer. I mean, it is, you know, combined. Everybody is in the same boat.
Correct.
So to tell the students, you keep paying full, we'll keep paying full, and everything is hunky-dory, may not be. That's why the government has put this.
Okay.
In my opinion.
Now coming to the next point is any staggering of class timings needed to facilitate better social distancing? I think you brief little bit about it, but if you can brief more on this.
Yeah, so I was just thinking that if schools have to commence on ground, not online, but if lockdown is over and you say we can start schools on ground, but you need to enforce social distancing. I have noticed that most schools post lunch, the buildings lie vacant. And if you were to look at a format of a morning shift and an evening shift, then you can reduce the load in the classes. If there were 40 children, then 20 could come in the morning and 20 could come in the evening, or that same class, 20 in one class and 20 in the other, and the other classes coming in the evening, whichever way you do it. You can, using the same infrastructure, get better student-teacher ratio, but you need more teachers. Or the teachers will have to work double the hours. Now, that is something which is, again, costly. You need to hire more teachers. Economics come into play. So this is what schools will have to work out. But yes, it is a model that may be workable. It's only a mindset that schools don't run in the evening. I have always wondered why our schools stop functioning post-lunch. Those buildings, all those classrooms lie vacant. Maybe extracurricular activities are going on. Special classes are going on. But most schools, I'm not talking about schools which function till 4 in the evening or 5. There are many schools which function only till about 2 o'clock or 1:30. Those kind of schools. That's what I felt.
Sir, many schools, at least in Maharashtra, most of the schools, they are working in two shifts, having a strength of more than 3,000 plus students. Now, if they are having from 7 to 12:30 and then again 12:45 to 6:37 with a huge strength, now how can we cope up with that? If a brief on that. See, the school which is working one shift.
I don't think these timings which we are talking of today will then be applicable in these trying times. You can get the senior students coming even later in the evening. You know, so we are right now in a very fixated mode. School start at such and such time, finish at such and such time. Everything will change. We are looking at new solutions, out-of-the-box solutions.
Yes.
The infrastructure is fixed. You need better ratio. Now you have to see how to do it. So I don't think we can be very strict about our timings. You may have to work longer hours. You may have to work odd hours. That is the only way forward. Otherwise, I'm sure the principal sitting here will have a solution.
Okay. Now my next question is, as we need to maintain social distancing, parents would not want to send their kids commute in the like buses and all school buses. So how would the school-going student commute? What do you think? What's your opinion?
No, I don't think that the buses can be a zero option. I don't see everybody going, you know, sending their school, their children to school by their own means. They will not be able to either afford it or it will not be manageable administratively also. But like yesterday's order of the government when the lockdown has been opened, where they've said that in the green zones, buses can ply with 50% strength.
Okay.
Something on that kind of a model, where a little bit more, a responsibility is taken by the school to ensure that they maintain that social distancing. Firstly, is reducing the number of children, then making sure they don't mix. Because children, like I said, don't listen. They'll be running, they'll be playing. So that kind of, it'll take a little time to set in that kind of discipline into the children to maintain the social distancing. But I think buses can be used if you can make sure that the numbers are reduced.
Okay, great, sir. Now, since the whole world is going digital, and everybody is trying to go online classes from their end. Now, what are your views, like after this COVID, after situation becomes normal and the students are able to go out and attend school, will technology replace teachers' classroom?
That is also. I don't think it can replace.
Reasons.
No technology can replace a teacher.
Correct.
But yes, the format can change. Instead of 100% contact classes, you may look at a 90-10, 80-20, 70-30, 60-40. That is now for the students to, the teachers to see how, you know, they want to interact with the students. But interaction has to be there. There's no question. Without a teacher, you can't teach.
I agree to this point because earlier, beyond academics, there are certain programs which does only offline. And we were told by many of the principals that this program doesn't work because everybody is going digital. Now the same digital world wants to just close down everything online and they want to be offline. So that is just the connect between the teacher, the student and the physical connect, the emotional connect, which makes a better learning. So it has to be a combination of technology as well as the physical classroom.
My opinion. This is my opinion. Yes. People will have different opinions.
Sir, my opinion too. And even for digital savvy people, they are sick and tired working 24/7. If we were doing offline work, at least we had few hours for ourselves. But I have seen this 1.5 months down the line, teachers, hats off. They are working 24/7, making videos, making preparing notes and sending it across. So this has become much more tougher and tedious.
No, that is because they don't have the material, because it's something new. But if you were to look at this as a way of going ahead, then all these classes which they are now making videos of would already be made and the banks would be given to them and then it would be much, much easier for them. So this is only a transitionary phase. You know, we are transiting from one system to the other system. There has to be a lot of difficulties. But these difficulties should not be taken as the reason why the new system can't work. Correct. It can work, but I still feel there needs to be contact. And that contact percentage can vary. It can vary depending upon the situation and the age of the students which are involved, the maturity.
Now see, many of us are not prepared and to how to deal with the post-lockdown scenario. So would you like to enlighten certain points on that? How to deal with the post-lockdown scenario?
What exactly are you looking at? You know, one is the professional part that I think the people who are here will talk more about.
No, I'm talking about the common man, the common parents. See, teachers, educationists, management, they are working their best. But if I talk about a common parent, how they are going to deal with it? Anything you can highlight on that?
No, I think this is going to be very difficult for informed parents to allow the children to go till they are vaccinated. Once a vaccine comes and children are vaccinated, then you have no fear. Then it's back to normal. It's back to, you know, business as usual. So this transitory phase between now and then is the trying time. In that, all the precautions that we talk of, social distancing, 6 feet gaps, all that will have to be looked at. Frequent washing of your hands, you know, wearing masks. I mean, we've been 2 months into this and everybody is aware of that.
Okay. Somebody has written, many schools in Mumbai are already working on two shifts. That's great, ma'am. And there is a question, any suggestion for online exam? So, sir, would you like to put any point, your views on that? Suggestion for online exam?
Yeah, I think online exams have been a format in many, many, the CAT and the ZAT and all these are online. But then they are for different level of people.
Correct.
To have online exams for students of, say, school, how do you ensure that the student has not used unfair means to, you know, provide his answers? So you will get then wrong results because then the whole aim of testing is just to see as to what level your students are at. But if that input coming to you is diluted by other means, if, you know, the unfair means are used, then you don't get a correct, clear picture of how much your student has learned. So my question would only be, how will you ensure that these are not, you know, assisted by unfair means? The examination because you are sitting at home. The whole question of online exams at home is different than online exams for ZATs and CATs, which go to centers where even, you know, where they are enforced not to talk to each other. But at home, there's nobody to enforce that. So that is something I'm not clear how it'll happen. Maybe there is a technology or maybe there is a way the people here will probably be able to give you some kind of.
Now, with this, I would like to connect, as you said, that the students may use unfair means to pass on the exam. So somehow down the line, we as educators, we feel that the spark of learning is somehow missing. So how do we bring back that spark for learning when it comes to students? When they resume their school, maybe after 2 months, 3 months.
But why do you feel the spark is missing?
Yeah, it is. We as
educators. That's your opinion. But have you done a survey? Have you got a statistics from students that we are not inspired to study? I think students are enjoying this lockdown. They don't have to go to school. That is what I always wanted to do throughout my school days.
Sir, currently they are enjoying. But what post that, how we need to bring back this spark? Currently they are enjoying that.
I think this is more a mindset amongst people who think their, you know, spark is gone. If you do a survey with students, probably you may get an outcome and it might be the spark is gone in their minds. Or not gone in their minds. I don't know. I don't think the spark should go by 2 months of lockdown. We are all locked down. And we are all, I think it's a very, very good time to introspect and do whatever you wanted to do. And there's so much more you can do out here. So why would you say the spark has gone down? I will not agree with that.
Even I don't agree because this disruptions brings two things. Either to break you or to make you, it depends upon us. We can innovate new things and we can just waste our own time. So it is totally upon us. So sir, my list of questions are done. Any suggestion you would like to give before I speak to everybody?
I think we have generally covered whatever I had listed out here. So I think it's good now for the people who are really involved in this to talk.
Okay. So we will welcome people, but I would like to just few things that we need to keep 4 hours to be kept in mind every time. Post-COVID, when we resume our schools, you have to reimagine the various options which can be worked. Maybe plan A may work for a particular school, but plan A may not work for another particular school. So we have to be ready with plan A, B, C, D. So reimagine, resolve all the problems that you may face once the school starts. Remeditate and reinvent. Reinvent all the possible ways, because all the points which we cover is a general point. You know in which particular area you will be facing problems when the kid starts coming back to you. Now, everybody has to be trained about the behavior change, about the hygiene, effectiveness, the mask rules, physical safety, because even if the kid starts coming to school, social distancing mask should be made compulsory in all the schools. Plan our sanitizations and other rules. We also need to make adequate instructions available at various places, at the notice board, at frequent places. Avoid shaking hands, use of masks. So the way we put up at notice boards frequently any important messages which we have to convey to the student. So the same way we have to use our own plan A, B, C, D, whatever works that, and you cannot just wait and watch and take action on that particular moment. We just have to just see all the trial and error because see this disruption was not at all planned. So now you all have to keep planning. Now I open the mute box. And if anybody would like to question, sir, directly. Sir, there is a question. How can we as school leaders support the parents in this lockdown?
Good question. I would feel whatever online classes are going, you're already supporting the parents because, you know, the children are now being engaged with your teachers for whatever time you have set. I'm not very familiar with how many hours are being spent online, but I surely know that, like you said, teachers are working day and night to engage with the students. Right. what more can be done? I think what you said in terms of your holistic learning programs, which you spoke of, maybe they could also be introduced to the parents so that the parents can look at not only academic education, but other education also, which is to be provided. Beyond that, I don't think I have any other answer to this. I'm sure people may have something which other people can suggest.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. And now I will unmute so that if any of the educationists have any questions, they can directly ask you. I have unmuted everybody. Anybody has a particular question? Pawan sir, can you mute? Pawan sir. Any question to sir? Dheeraj sir? Anybody would like to ask any particular question? I think sir, all their queries are solved because no question is coming up. Anybody would like?
But I'd like to know. But let's get to some kind of conclusion from the principals. That are they going to look at questions? Are they going to look at?
Shikha ma'am, can you give your feedback? Shikha ma'am, can you give your feedback? Joshna ma'am. Farzana ma'am, I can see you online. Would you like to give your feedback, your opinion on this? Farzana ma'am. Dheeraj Mehrotra sir. Yes, Shikha ma'am.
Rashna ma'am.
Yeah.
I would like to let you know that we really had a brainstorming session with sir. Thank you so much for resolving all the queries the principal were having in our mind, because right now seriously we are into the economic crisis as we are in the high school. We would request you to put some light on the part, like as we are residing in the remote areas, so how can we enhance some technical education or some smart board, smart class education basically we said, and moreover, how can we increase more and more moral quotient, I must tell you, moral quotient implemented in the brains of our students. So 2 points and 2 questions I have for you.
Okay.
I think we spoke about this. Now the smart class concept, obviously, sitting in the class, you will now have to impart that to students at the home. So it's only, I think it's only a matter of technical detail how this happens. If you have bandwidth, or if you're going to send it through offline device like a pen drive or a CD, but the same package which you were using in your smart classes out here can be sent to them at home. The moral quotient part is what I also said, that schools are not only for academic instruction, but they're also for a holistic development, for which Rachna said that she has a program, and I'm not aware actually what program, but surely that question should go to her as to how her program will address this part of the query that you have.
Sir, I will forward it to you.
No, to her.
Shikha ma'am,
I don't know.
If you like to speak, then you can unmute yourself.
Okay, yes. Can I put a question?
Yes,
to sir.
Yes, sir, you can.
Yeah, what do you think canceling assemblies and sports games and other events would be feasible? Because assembly is one of the prime deliveries in a school. So how do you coordinate that?
I personally feel assemblies can still be done. Whatever you do in the assembly can be done, but you don't have to assemble for it. Yeah. It can be done by students being in their classrooms and you imparting the same kind of information or procedure or whatever you follow in your assembly whilst they are in their classrooms.
Yeah, thank you.
But the process must go on, because like you said, that is the main part of the
school functioning. Yeah. That is very big.
As far as sports days and all concerned, I don't think it will happen, because even, internationally, like cricket matches, there is going to be no spectators. So you can't be sitting in a stadium unless, you have social distancing, which is not possible. It won't be then economically viable. So the only way, for example, for these international matches to go on, whether it's football and cricket, which are so popular, can be a live telecast. Now, that may not be applicable in schools. The whole aim of the sports day gets defeated if you are going to maintain social distancing. So that might take a hit till the time that you come up with a vaccine.
And any recommendations for some warm-up exercises? Maybe that. I think the teachers are doing a wonderful job through even webinars.
That can be done with social distancing. All that can be done. That can be done. But provided the parents send their children to your school and are confident that the social distancing will be maintained and respected. The whole question is about that.
Yeah, I believe even in my school days, we used to take one arm distance, one and a half arm distance to stand and do our exercises. So probably in a habit of standing at distance apart and doing things. Thank you.
Dheeraj Mehrotra, sir, would you like to add on something or ask a question?
Well, I did so. Thank you very much. And I really appreciate you and the wonderful speaker, Sir Dogra. And it is really a high time. But now I think it is the responsibility of the schools also to promote information sharing, adapt the new school policies, and we need to revamp our whole system of school management, monitor the school attendance in the best of the possible ways, and plan for continuity of learning. As he rightly said, that the use of online and e-learning strategies need to be a part of the curriculum delivery in our schools through the assigning of reading and exercises for the home study in a different manner altogether. And I also believe there was a request from the people to the government that we can start some radio podcast or television broadcast or a particular edu channel or something by the government where we can initiate on board-wise deliberations, as it is the high time for all of us. So I believe through your channel or through your need, this can go to the government that there is an urgent need of some educational channel officially. I think the board should come together and deliver some one-hour talk or one-hour learning to make the go happen. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, Pratibha ma'am, would you like to add on something? Pratibha ma'am from Mumbai. Ma'am, can you hear us? Jyotsna ma'am, would you like to add on something?
Jyotsna ma'am.
Yes,
Farzana ma'am from Assam.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to add on. Thank you for such wonderful session, first of all. And here, I would like to add up what Dheeraj sir just said. I think ICSC has already started a channel on television. And then state government has also started since yesterday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. for the children, wherein they are taking the revised academic themes for different classes. Secondly, when we were talking about how to conduct assemblies and exercises part, then I would like to say Fit India Active Life from 9:30 to 10 every day is already going on during this lockdown period. And I, along with assignments, I'm sharing all these things with my children every day. I have shared prayer. I have shared pledge. I have shared the meditation that they used to do in the school to start their day and the exercises that Fit India does every morning. Both children might not have access to live sessions. So what I do, once it's done after 10 o'clock, I watch it myself and then I share it with my children. Then I'm sharing with them library reading sessions plus conducting online competitions with them on all significant days. Like we had World Health Day, we had World Earth Day recently. I'm inviting guest speakers because children were used to having guest speakers in school during significant days for special assemblies. So we have been doing these along with sending the assignments. So it's all possible. It's just, you know, change of slightly the mindset and the strategies that will spread positivity and happiness in the families also. So school can spread positivity in the families to reduce the stress during this unprecedented time. And it's possible, everything is possible if school head is positive.
Yes.
So correct. Thank you, Krishna ma'am.
So can I ask you a question? Can I ask a question?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Firstly, what are you looking at in your school post-lockdown ending? and before the vaccine is introduced. Are you going to carry on in this format for the next year, year and a half?
So still September, we are expecting. I don't think government is allowing school children to reach school. What I am expecting.
Don't talk about the government. Let's say government is allowed.
It's not safe. Mass gathering is not safe in any way. And children at that age are actually the vulnerable lot who are at risk. So even we will not prefer. So, but what we are doing right now is going as per their syllabus, even the assignments that we are sending. We have
My question is different. My question is, for the next 1 year, year and a half, till the vaccine comes, what is your plan? Is it going to remain status quo as it is today? Or are you in some form looking at reverting to what you were earlier?
See, reverting to what we were earlier may not be possible, maybe till 2022. What across the world globally people are expecting, because if this infection is worldwide. So we have to come up with new strategies of working. Maybe, as you said, it will add economic value to it.
Ask so you, then whatever you decided in your leader, school.
No, as a school leaders, by the time, see, parents will also realize, because it's all about their children, what we are thinking for. So maybe we come up with new strategies, new ways of working with parents' collaboration and their understanding. And we come up to a common solution how to go about the thing in future. Because see, it's not happening in a localized way. It's happening globally. And in India, things are different. People are different. The resources are different. Financially, the status is different. So we have to work on all factors and come to a common practical solution which can be implemented.
So far, nothing has been decided. We don't know where we are going.
Nobody knows.
That's exactly what I'm trying to tell you. The writing is on the wall. I don't know why you all are not seeing it. That nobody is going to come to your schools till you get a vaccine. So what are you waiting for? Why are you not coming up with a new strategy? Government is not going to give you a strategy. Government is only going to tell you lockdown is over. No, your students will not come because I will not send. I'm a parent. I will not send my child because I'm scared. So you have to see how you're going to take it ahead from here. There'll be no more inputs from the government. CBSE won't tell you how to do it.
No, no. What we are doing, obviously, will go ahead because we are going syllabus-wise. We are just not running online classes just for to keep the children.
So for a year and a half, that's what you're going to do?
We are prepared for it. Our parents are prepared.
That's what I'm asking. That's what I asked.
Yeah.
So schools will not function for a year and a half. Adding staff and choose to function in the schools. Are you going to sack them? Or they will just stand down in the schools? You have administrative staff in the school, no?
Yes. Administrative
you have buses.
PC helping
you have...
all staff.
So you will sack them all?
No, why should we sack them all?
Because
they
are the ones
working and providing things, but we'll come to a practical solution if things continue like this for another 2-3 months. Because see, in the end, we all are paying salaries. And for students and their academics and their extracurricular activities, what we are doing, we'll continue the same. And we'll add on more better plannings. With better planning, we'll come up with more projects and things.
My question was more specific to do with loss of jobs. If you are not going to be paid for, building fund and a development fund with schools charge, transportation fees, are you going to sack or are you going to cut salaries? You must have thought of something, because finally the economics is what drives the whole institution.
See, or you're going to say... Ambanis, they all have come up with, major cuts in the salaries of their CEOs plus...
I'm asking you. Sir, don't talk of other people. What are you going to do?
All work as an association, sir. It's not
sir,
my...
Sir, we all are working, sir. Let me interfere on this.
We are working on it.
I think the debate is on. Hello. I think the debate is on, and it is we have to follow the Sahodaya guidelines. And the management of the school has to come up and bear the loss, if any. And also we need to abide by the rules set by the government. If they say that we have to follow a guideline and not getting re-recognized or something, we need to. We are also handcuffed in that direction. So let's see. Let's be positive. And of course, the Sahodayas and the chairman of all the Sahodayas are brainstorming virtually, and I was just going through yesterday only, there was a group of over 100 principals in Delhi who were doing a brainstorming, and I was a part of a group as an observer where they're planning out strategies, and then that is going to be shared by the board officials to follow it through circulars. So I'm looking forward to all what sir has rightly said, that it is going to be hard task for all of us to deliver, but certainly there is going to be hope, and we need to motivate our children and our teachers, particularly on ground of keeping them no layoffs and being positive. Thank you.